morning, and thank you for joining us in our weekly offering of online worship. If you have a prayer book, we begin on page 355, or you can click on the link in your video description to find, to go to our website for an order of service. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you have built your church upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. Grant us so to be joined together in unity of spirit by their teaching, that we may be made a holy temple acceptable to you through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. Amen.
The first lesson is from the book of Genesis. God tested Abraham. He said to him, Abraham. And he said, Here I am. He said, Take your only son, Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah, and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains that I shall show you. So Abraham rose early in the morning, saddled his donkey, and took two of his young men with him and his son Isaac. He cut the wood for the burnt offering and set out and went to the place in the distance that God had shown him. On the third day, Abraham looked up and saw the place far away. Then Abraham said to his young men, Stay here with the donkey. The boy and I will go over there. We will worship, and then we will come back to you. Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it on his son Isaac, and he himself carried the fire and the knife. So the two of them walked on together. Isaac said to his father, Abraham, Father. And he said, Here I am, my son. He said, The fire and the wood are here, but where is the lamb for a burnt offering? Abraham said, God himself will provide the lamb for a burnt offering, my son. So the two of them walked on together. When they came to the place that God had shown him, Abraham built an altar there and laid the wood in order. He bound his son Isaac and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. Then Abraham reached out his hand and took the knife to kill his son. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, "Abraham, Abraham." And he said, "Here I am." He said, "Do not lay your hand on the boy or do anything to him, for now I know that you fear God, since you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me." And Abraham looked up and saw a ram caught in a thicket by its horns. Abraham went and took the ram and offered it up as a burnt offering instead of his son. So Abraham called that place, "The Lord will provide." As it is said to this day, on the mount of the Lord it shall be provided. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The second lesson is from Paul's letter to the Romans. Do not let sin exercise dominion in your mortal bodies to make you obey their passions. No longer present your members to sin as instruments of wickedness, but present yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and present your members to God as instruments of righteousness. For sin will have no dominion over you, since you are not under law, but under grace. What then? Should we sin because we are not under law, but under grace? By no means. Do you not know that if you present yourselves to anyone as obedient slaves, you are slaves of the one whom you obey, either of sin, which leads to death, or of obedience, which leads to righteousness? But thanks be to God that you, having once been slaves of sin, have become obedient from the heart to the form of teaching to which you were entrusted, and that you, having been set free from sin, have become slaves of righteousness. I am speaking in human terms because of your natural limitations. For just as you once presented your members as slaves to impurity and greater iniquity, so now present your members as slaves to righteousness for sanctification. When you were slaves of sin, you were free in regard to righteousness. So what advantage did you then get from these things of which you are now ashamed? The end of those things is death. But now that you have been freed from sin and enslaved to God, the advantage you get is sanctification. The end is eternal life, for the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said, "Whoever welcomes you welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. Whoever welcomes a prophet in the name of a prophet will receive a prophet's reward. And whoever welcomes a righteous person in the name of a righteous person will receive the reward of the righteous. And whoever gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones in the name of a disciple, truly I tell you, none of these will lose their reward." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen. My wife Amy has always said that being married to me can be a bit maddening at times, but never boring. And over the years, we have had our share of adventures together. But I'm not sure we ever had a bigger adventure than when we moved to New York City for a year. You see, prior to my ordination in the Episcopal Church, I was asked by my bishop to do a year of post-baccalaureate study at General Seminary in New York City. And I have to say that living in the city, it stretched us. Now, please understand that Amy and I were both very much small-town people. Both of us were born and raised in small towns, and then both of us went away to college in small towns. And then for our first 3 years as a married couple, we lived together in yet another very small town in central Kentucky. And suffice it to say, that there were many things we simply had to get used to living in New York City. The hustle, the bustle, and all that noise. And I just channeled my inner Grinch there. But you know, I think the thing that struck both of us the most about living in the city was seeing homeless people. Now, at the time, we were living in a small apartment on the corner of 10th Avenue and 20th Street in the Chelsea neighborhood, which was a pretty good neighborhood, even back then. But even living in Chelsea, we would still see homeless people every single day. And I could never really get used to the heartbreaking reality of seeing people living on the street. After all, we never saw homeless people when we lived in Wilmore, Kentucky, population 5,793. It was jarring. Now, at the same time that we moved to the city, the daughter of my favorite priest in the Diocese of Lexington, Kentucky, well, she had also moved to New York to attend college. And we got together with her several times during that year. And I remember hearing her say that she started carrying single dollar bills with her whenever she went into the city, so that she always had something, a little something, to give to people in need. Rachel was a remarkable, remarkable girl. And that sounded like a really good idea to me. So Amy and I also started bringing singles with us so that we would have something to give. Now, we didn't have much. As a matter of fact, we were living on a shoestring budget in a tiny 376 square foot apartment. A hot date for us back then was takeout Chinese. But we still wanted to do something. All because a simple college student from Kentucky inspired us to do something. Now, was that a grand gesture? Hardly. Giving a dollar here and there doesn't qualify us for sainthood in anyone's book. It was just a little thing. But sometimes those little things, they matter. And I'm reminded of that fact by our gospel account for today. Now, this account is a continuation of the gospels from the last couple of weeks as Jesus commissions his disciples and then sends them out to do the work of the kingdom. And quite frankly, over the course of the last couple of weeks, kingdom work, it hasn't sounded really all that appealing. Jesus has told his disciples that he is sending them out like sheep into the midst of wolves. He's told them they have to pick up their cross and follow him. He's told them that they are going to have to leave behind all the comforts of home and spend their lives curing the sick. He's told them that they are going to be dragged in front of the civil authorities and flogged in synagogues. And oh yeah, by the way, following him may well lead to dissension in their own family. Well, wow, Jesus, where do we all sign up? And all of this makes Christianity and doing kingdom work sound absolutely horrible, to the point of martyrdom. But today, Jesus talks more about the simple and mundane work of the kingdom. He talks about hospitality and simple acts of kindness. Jesus says that kind and welcoming people are valued and recognized in the kingdom of God. And he tells his disciples that even something as simple as offering a cup of water is significant and thusly rewarded. in the midst of an often cold and indifferent world, simple acts of kindness and hospitality, well, they actually mean something to our God. And if that sounds like good news to you, well, it should. Because quite frankly, I don't think too many of us are wanting to run out and sign up for that premier flogging in the synagogue and martyrdom package now, are we? And to be completely honest, if you are wanting to rush out to die a painful death for Jesus today, well, I'm going to have to put you in time out for just a little while. But simple kindness and hospitality? Well, heck, we can certainly do that, can't we? But here's the thing. Many people rarely even do the smallest of things for other people. We have become such a cynical and untrusting and unfeeling and fearful and fragmented and polarized culture that simple kindness is often forgotten. I mean, we go to work and we work long hours. We put our head down and we walk from place to place. And sometimes we don't even recognize the little places to serve God's people. I'm not talking about being heroic. I'm talking about just doing the little things. I'm talking about smiling at a stranger instead of ignoring them. I'm talking about offering a kind word to the people in front of you in the checkout line. I'm talking about listening to a coworker talk about their life with a semblance of interest. I'm talking about returning someone's phone call or text. I'm talking about buying a cup of coffee for someone who's having a bad day. You remember those things? Remember those little things? Well, guess what? They matter. They matter to people, and they matter to our God. They probably aren't going to make headlines anywhere, and they will mostly go unnoticed to the rest of the world. But they matter. I am constantly amazed at how people respond to simple kindness because they simply are not used to receiving it. People in need have become so accustomed to being ignored that they are often astonished when someone takes the time to actually be kind to them. For God's sake, what has happened to us? When did we get so wrapped up in our own privatized little worlds that we have forgotten about basic human kindness? Folks, a cup of water, it matters. A smile, it matters. Giving 5 minutes of our precious time, it matters. It matters to the people we meet. And it matters to our God. You know, just recently I have taken to reading the Facebook posts from the husband of one of my colleagues in ministry. I've never actually met this gentleman, but I always look forward to reading about what he has to say because he's one of those incredibly positive people. He's a publicity director for Disney Publishing, and he spends quite a bit of time on the road. But instead of filling his wall with posts about how horrible the world is and how horrible his day has been, and all the nastiness that he sees in his many travels, he very often posts simply about the people he meets. Posts about the homeless people he befriends and he actually talks to, knows them by name. He talks about helping the sick person he meets on the train. I have never even met this guy, but he inspires me to be a better person than I am simply because he takes the time to offer a little bit of kindness and hospitality. And I can tell you that he is not self-promoting either, because believe me, after all these years in the church, I can smell self-promotion from 100 paces. He's just promoting kindness. He's just promoting the kingdom of God. And that is exactly what we do every single time we offer just a little bit of ourselves. Go ahead and try it sometime. We don't have to be heroes. We don't have to be martyrs. We just have to be decent human beings. Life is too short. It's too short to spend it being fearful and isolated. Folks, even in these difficult and polarizing times, this world of ours can be such a beautiful place when we take the time to clean up our own little corner of it. And it all starts with a cup of water. It all starts with a little hospitality and a little kindness. So let's lift up our gazes from our shoes today, just a little bit, and be present in this world today. And let's give just a little bit. Every little bit matters. It matters to our fellow humans, and it certainly matters to our God. And it's a good first step on our happy road to the kingdom. Amen.
Let us continue our worship by saying together the words of our faith in the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again. In accordance with the scriptures, he ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray for the church and for the world. Grant, Almighty God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Guide the people of this land and of all the nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give us all a reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others and to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bless all whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We commend to your mercy all who have died, that your will for them may be fulfilled. And we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, you have promised to hear what we ask in the name of your Son. Accept and fulfill our petitions, we pray, not as we ask in our ignorance, nor as we deserve in our sinfulness, but as you know and love us in your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Be careful as you go into God's creation, for it does not belong to you. Be gentle with yourself and with others, for we are the dwelling place of the Most High. Be alert and be silent, for God is a whisper. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you this day and remain with you always. Amen.